It's fun, it's exciting, it may be scary right now. That's perfectly normal, but I think as we go along, it will get better. And where do we start? And I cannot say pray, pray, pray. It may sound strange to you, but I literally pray all the time for students that God will close doors for them. He will open doors and He will close doors. And those closed doors are really a gift. At the time, they may not feel it, but He ultimately wants the very best for you. And so He is going to close doors. I've already this year had two doors closed on students I didn't see. On paper, it doesn't make sense. But knowing that our Father wants the very best, it means that they have something better in store. And they don't see it right now, but I think they will. One of the big things I really want to say right off the get-go is encourage each other, especially students and even parents. For some reason, the college admission process can get very competitive. I have not seen it nearly as bad as at Caldwell that I've seen it in my previous two schools. But the whole scores, the SAT and ACT, if you think of it, those are scores that students have earned. Just like in our jobs, we earn a salary, or it's a private matter. And so for someone to say, what did you get on your SAT or ACT, is really a rude question. It's a private question, so please don't. And if somebody does, for students, if they do ask you that, because really, if you think about it, only one person in that conversation comes out feeling good about it, and it's the person with the higher score. For some reason, there's the little pump up, like, oh, I did better. You know, I mean, they're not going to say that. Just say, I'm in my range. I'm within my range. Or, I'm not within my range. I'm taking it again. But don't give it. You do not have to give a number, okay? So just want to give you that okay, not to go there. Words of wisdom. Every year I contact my students and say, what would you say to the students? What do you know now that you wish you would have known? Students, work ahead of the deadlines. I will give you deadlines, and I really am a nice person. And so when I say you have 24 hours to meet your deadline, I really mean it. And the reason I'm going to say that is from this point all the way through college, deadlines don't change. Deadlines mean deadlines. And I want to get you used to that, okay? I'm going to treat you much more like a college student than I am a high school student from this point forward, just because I want to prepare you. 1 in 4 college students do not return their sophomore year. It's not academics. It's the soft skills. It's following through. It's meeting deadlines, turning things in. So I'm going to kind of try to help you. And we'll talk more about the October 1st deadline. In the summer, we will have a workshop. We just got notice of our start date, which is going to be a little bit later. First day of school is going to be towards the end of August more. So we'll probably do it the first week of August. We will have a workshop for applications and essays where you'll come in and we'll spend afternoons working on your applications, on your essays. So when you come back to school, I would say 50% of the seniors were done with applications. And they were ready to start their senior year. Because you come back and you go to Italy, and senior year is a tough year. So if you can get that behind you, it really relieves a lot of stress. Starting now, visit as many schools as possible. Even if you're just driving, like Thanksgiving, Christmas, if you're driving by a campus, even if you just drive through it, and I'm going to talk a little bit in a minute about a college trip that we're going to plan for February. It literally is not so much about the 6 schools on the college trip. It's more about, do I like a large school? Do I like a small school? Does this feel too far away? It's all of those things. And then when you get back, we can sit down as, you know, and look for individual schools that fit kind of what you're looking at. Take responsibility. Do not let your parents fill out forms. Fill out every form. I'm going to, towards the end, you'll be getting a manual, and there's forms in there that you will fill out before we have our individual meetings. Have you fill them out from this point forward, anything to do with college, you fill them out. SAT, ACT, you get online and register for those tests because you need to know where that information is. I have students all the time in college that they need their SAT test or they need to get their APs to get credit. They have no idea how to do that. So the more that you do it, the better. The other thing I'm going to say about that one also, this one's hard for parents. From this point forward, if it has to do with college, I really want the student to come and talk to me. I will not meet, in most 90% of the cases, if we're going to talk about college, the student's going to be there. Because there's not a learning process going on if the parent and I just talk. The student, it's about the student going to college. And so the three of us can always talk. But if you have a question, encourage your student to come in and ask me. I'm really nice, I won't, and I'm a good person to start with. They have to advocate this whole process, and then college, you're not gonna be there. They've gotta get used to asking questions with adults that they don't know. And then SAT, their other thing was the SAT, ACT study. What they found most helpful was the practice online test on the SAT and ACT websites. You can do the practice test. And hands down, the thing I always hear is, the more you read the questions, the more you see how the test is written. And sometimes you won't know the answer just because of the way it was written, you'll know the answer. Parents, the big one is always, we are not applying to college. It is the student that is applying to college. And that is a real offensive, I guess, that PAC system, they feel the pressure. This one I actually had to learn the hard way. I have two daughters, and I guess I talked a little bit too many questions about college, and they come home every single day because I always had lots of questions, and it drove really a wedge between, especially my older one. I learned by the time my second one is set up a schedule. What we did is literally we set up a calendar, and we had it Sunday night, so we'd always order pizza. We'd sit around the table, and we would have a calendar of what she needed to do, and then during the week, as she got it done, she would cross it off. So I never had to ask. I didn't have to. And we just went along with our family life. And it wasn't all about college, because this is their last year and a half of high school. So stay in high school while you're going through this process. And I have to say, our second one, it was hands down so much less stress. This one I hear all the time. Do not talk to your friends about your child's scores, grades, and college choices. That feels very competitive with them, and they, you know, again, it's their thing. It's their story to tell. So if they want the neighbor to know, they'll tell the neighbor. And we'll talk a little bit more about this one. Talk to your child now about your financial, what your family can afford for college. Every year I have those students that apply to a school, for most of the time it's out of state, dream school, they want to get in, they get in, and then March parents say, we can't afford it. And so, if you say now we can afford X amount, and if you want to apply to those schools, that's fine, but know that if you don't get scholarships or whatever and get it down to this price, it won't be an option. A lot of heartache doing that. There's a college for everybody. There's the liberal arts colleges were more the private, the High Points, the Davidson, the Elon. Those are going to focus more on the undergrad. You're going to be taught by professors. Community colleges, two-year, that's becoming more popular to do the associate and then transfer into a four-year university career would be more, you're learning a trade. We have one that is looking at a culinary school. And then the university is kind of a lot of colleges within, under one big umbrella. So you're, you know, NC State, UNC, those are going to be, they're much larger, a lot of times research. So you often are taught by undergrad students your first 2 years. My daughter went to Virginia Tech, didn't have really a professor until her junior year. She was taught by a 22-year-old. So then she went to her grad school, and what was she? She was an English teacher for 2 years to the freshmen. And she used to say, I feel like I literally need to write an apology letter to the parents. Because they never saw the professor. She was their 22-year-old. She had no right, you know, teaching them, but it paid her grad school. And so those are the pros and cons. And you'll hear, you know, the benefits. And we'll talk about that as we go along. What is best for you? And that's why it isn't one school that equals success. You know, like if you get into this school, you, hands down, you're going to have a successful. It's not that way. It's really based on the student and what they need. So what does make a college fit? Three things. The personal fit, the academic fit, and the financial fit. We're going to talk about the personal fit programs. Does your school have the major, what kind of internships do they have? Is a Christian school the best thing for you? Do you want all guy, all girl, where you're focused more, you know, an all girls school where it's just all about the girls, and it's a different kind of learning style or different environment. Location, do you want, how far do you want to go? And a lot of these kind of things are in the packet that you're gonna fill out for me. Because this is where I really want you to think about what do you want, how are you wired, before you and I sit down and we start talking about a school, we need to decide what we're looking for. This is a big one, and as you're deciding it, I want you to keep your eyes on the truth. Define success for yourself. For students, when I said, I was in the 10th grade last week, and I said, what is success for you? Making a lot of money, making, you know, there was all different, and there wasn't a right or wrong, but what is your success? What do you want? You know, one was, I want to have a family, and I want to be involved in their lives, and that kind of thing. Okay, well, if that's the goal, then we can work backwards from that. But what is it that you want? What is it that we're going for? What's the goal? Focus on your gifts and passions. You know, I have students all the time come in and say, I want to go into medicine. Great, let's, you know, why? Because they make a lot of money and they, you know, it's a secure job, it'll always, that's great. And then I look at their report cards. Not so much in science and math, you know, but they're great at in the humanities. And so look at your gifts and passions, and a career is just what you're doing for the world. What are you giving back? And so if you're not using your gifts and passions in a career, everybody loses. You're going to be miserable. You know, you're going to, a successful career is that field that just you wake up in the morning for. Resist peer pressure. That, you know, I have one senior, he actually doesn't go here, it's through my church I'm working with. He wants nothing more than to be a baker. He loves making cakes, he loves, but he's really embarrassed. He plays football. I mean, he just doesn't, when we think of bakers, we just, he's not really that picture. But he has such a passion for it and he's phenomenal at it. And so getting him to accept, this is where I'm at, and finally applying to a culinary school, and he got accepted, he is like a different, he's lighting up, you know. It's I can't wait to see what God does with his gift, because definitely has a gift. This was my biggest pet peeve, is the college, the rankings. You see them, U.S. News. This is just U.S. News. You'll see Princeton Review. What I want you to ask yourself when you see those rankings, what are they ranking? What is the criteria behind that? This is just for the U.S. News. 25% of their score is based on a college admission score. So a college admission is giving a school, it can be across the country, they know nothing about, and they have to give that school a score, a competitive score that they know nothing about. 20% is faculty. How much does the salary of the faculty and the number of full-time professors? 20%. Now this one, I do think it's somewhat important of the education you're getting. How many students return their sophomore year to that school? And like I said, now 1 in 4 are not returning to college. So they are starting to track what schools are really falling behind on that. Selective, so it's how high are the SAT, ACT scores? And that's only 15%. 10% is how much money is spent. 5% graduation within 6 years for a 4-year degree. And then alumni donations. So when you look at that, does that really impact the quality of education you're going to get? Or does it sell magazines? And does it sell, you know, when I go to conferences and sit across with, I go to for the high school, and it's always 50% high school, 50% college. Talk about a fired up crew, because they're playing this game all the time to keep their ranks up, and they realize it really has nothing to do with the quality of what they're doing. So all that to say, when you look at those rankings, please don't buy the magazine, because I mean, it's not what is going to indicate what's best for your student. How adults can help. This book, I went to the NACAC this past September, and Madeline Levine, I'm not sure if you're familiar with her, she wrote The Price of Privilege and Teach Your Children Well. I'd recommend both of those books. Teach Your Children Well is excellent. And this was a quote that she wrote in there, and I think it's great. While we hope that our children will do well in school, our main concern is how they will do well in life. And I think if we keep that in perspective of the whole college process, it refocuses us. Because what do we want them to be at 25 versus so much focus on where they go at 18 to college? Our job is to help them know and appreciate themselves deeply, to be resilient in the face of adversity. That's where, let them fall. Let them make mistakes. Let them have consequences now, so they know how to get back up and, you know, realize what they did wrong, try another way, and be successful. That's right there why the 1 in 4 are not returning. They do not know how to get back up. For the time, I'm going to keep going on. The academic fit, that was the second one. Remember, we had the personal, the academic. The academic is what kind of setting is best for you, what kind of learning style. And one of the things you're going to do is a learning style, because that really does make a big difference. If you're a student that has a lot of questions in class and need things, you learn from other people asking questions, you like that discussion base, sitting in a 300 student auditorium lecture style, that, you know, the professor or TA giving the presentation way down there is not going to be the best learning style for you. And the SAT, ACT is going to be an academic fit. This is kind of when colleges look at what's most important across the board. This is what it is. Grades and rigor are number one. They're always going to look, and it's not based on how many, it's based on what was offered to you. Our school offers 5 APs. If you took 4 APs, you would be considered the most demanding because our 5th AP is Latin. If you're in Spanish, you cannot take AP Latin. So you would be, 4 would be your, even if you are in AP Latin, it's being in a small school and where our schedule is, a college would look at 4 being the most demanding. They wouldn't expect 5 because they understand that with schedule, the way schedule is, most students couldn't take 5. How many honors, how many APs did you take? That's the rigor. And the grades, B, A, and B is what they're going to want to see. So if that means that you could get an A or a B in a honors, but a C in an AP, go for the A or B. Go for the honors. Okay, so push yourself to that A or B in whatever rigor that is. Next would be the SAT, ACT, and last is the activities. And just notice how the activities is smaller. I have so many students that will have no rigor and very low grades, but they've been in everything. And that's great, but it's not, it's upside down. Okay, so your activity should come after you're able to do the rigor and the grades. I'm not going to go into a lot of this. SAT, ACT, what I do want to say, please, everyone, take 1 ACT and 1 SAT. The best time to take the, to start as a junior to take it is in January. Because the way that it is scored how everybody in the country did on that particular test. Right now, seniors are taking it, so you're getting compared with the seniors and juniors taking it. If you wait till January, seniors no longer are taking it. It's the first time that juniors, just juniors, are taking it. Because it's right after the holidays, a lot of juniors don't take it. Scores, as we track them, scores tend to be the highest that first January, February test date for juniors. So take one of each, figure out, we can look at it, see what kind of test taker you are. They're very different tests. And then retake the one that you did best by June. Okay, there's test dates in April, May, and June, whatever one works best for you. That way, when you leave for the summer, you have 2 scores at least. That may be, you may be done. That may be enough for the schools that you have, that you've just decided you're going to apply to. But if not, you could come back and take one more in that September, October. It's not, I'd love to have you done before fall, just because the October date, more and more colleges are moving up their admissions early action deadline. So I have some this year that really want to go, but I don't, their test scores, I'm not as certain on that. So if you can, get them done early, okay? Also, the subject test, I do want to say, some of the more selective colleges are going to want you to take subject tests. So as we look at your list more, especially the IVs, Duke, they're going to want, you want to take those in June or at the end of the, like if you're going to do a chemistry or the English, do it at the end of the AP English, like at the end of your highest level that you've taken. Okay, and I can talk to you more about that because it's just a few students that will take those. SuperScore, you will be able to send scores in. However, this is my thin line of the business part. Schools, colleges are going to say, send us all your scores. That is to their benefit. They're trying to even the playing field. If they have a student, because not every student can afford to take a test multiple times. I have students that have taken it four times. There are students that can afford to take it once. So if they have a student with the exact same score that has taken it once and one has four times in order to get that score, they're going to favor the one that took once. So you don't want to send both SAT and ACT. Just send whatever one you did best, and we can super score. So like if you have two test dates, and on the first test that you did better in critical reading, but you went way up in math the second, we'd send both test scores and they will super score it. So they'll put whatever one you got the highest in, okay? And that's where you can, when you register to take the test, you can send your scores to four schools. The problem with that is you don't know what until you're done, what test you're going to send and what one is going to be the highest. So if money is, you know, really, really tight, go ahead and do that and send it four schools free. Or you can hold it, wait till you're completely done with your test taking, and then send the scores that you're going to, and I think it's $9 to do that, where you send the scores that best reflect you to that college. When you apply, and we'll talk more about this, the target, the reach, and the safety. Typically, I get students that come in with a long list of reach schools and don't really want to pay attention to the target or safety. Reach schools are going to be, when you look up, you know, when you look up a school and the average, the 50% range of their SAT and the 50% of their GPA, if your scores are under that, it's a reach school for you. A reach school, you have to think of, you're going to be in the class with other students that are in that 50% or higher. So is it, you know, for some students, that's okay. Some students, that fires them up and motivates them, and that's okay. Other students, they spend their 4 years of college, you know, it happened 2 years ago, I had a student way below. I mean, I thought it was crazy. She was applying to NC State, and she had learning differences, low SAT, ACT, but connections, family money, grandpa, I mean, it was this whole thing. She got in. It was amazing she got in. It has been the most pitiful thing to watch. Because this will be her, she's entering her, should be third year. She has not passed enough to have a full freshman year. And yet, she's going to be there by 6-7 years. I mean, it's just awful. It's just not a good fit, but they want that NC State diploma. So the target is where you want to spend most of your time looking for, and that is where you are in that range. So you're going to be in the classroom with like-minded, likability students. And then your safety school, also a good place to look if you're thinking of grad schools. Because grad school is going to be based on your GPA, your class ranking, and what you do. And so if you're in a school where you're at the top, you know, you're at the top of your class, you're able to have interactions with professors and get internships and research, and that's going to make a great resume for either grad school or med school or whatever you want that next. Then that, and that's where you're going to get employed by, is your master's, not your undergrad. So we'll talk about those, but those are kind of the definition of those. Then the last one is the financial fit. You can go on any college admission, and up in that little search engine, put net price calculator and bring it up every college. college needs to have one of these. You can put your information in. You can put your GPA, your SAT, your family income, and it will pull up and give you an estimate of like scholarships that you would be eligible for, and give you kind of a rough estimate of how much that college would be for you. Okay? We talked about that. You have your, and I do want to say on the 19th, we are having a financial aid meeting. It's a, he was here, I guess, 2 years ago. So he's kind of a financial planner for college. And so that will be in this room at 7:30 in the 19th. The way the application, just really briefly, so that you kind of get a head, know the how it's going to run. The students will submit the application, the essay application fee, and the SAT, ACT scores every year. Students miss that one and they think, I can send it. I cannot send your scores because you have made, it's like a contract with those test centers. So you have to log that on when you decide where your application and have those tests sent to your school. Then I will send your transcript, the profile, my recommendation, and you will ask for 2 recommendation letters. I say teachers, one definitely has to be a teacher. I really recommend somebody else that knows you, because 2 teacher recommendation letters, they really sound a lot alike. You know, it's how you are as a student. Some of the best ones I've read this year are employers. Hands down, and they were phenomenal because it talks about their work ethic, their maturity, how they are out in public. I read some good pastor ones, a couple Eagle Scouts, they're on that track. So somebody else, but start thinking now about who that is that you would ask, okay? And it should be a junior or senior teacher. What's next? Okay, this is where I'm going to get, can I get a couple of our students? The manual's over here. Yeah, could you help a couple of students? On the boxes under here are your manuals, and they have your name on them. When you open them up, when you return that to me, and before Christmas, because I really spent a lot of time during Christmas going through those and really finding out a lot about you, to be honest, and coming up with great options of maybe some schools to look at. So then when you get that packet, that we will set up an individual meeting with you, with a student, and at least one parent. Okay? Did anybody have any questions? I promised teachers that I would not let you over, and I kind of did, but just a few minutes. Did anybody have any questions? Yes. No, it is in the manual, in the binder. Do you know the SAT or the exams when they are?
For the holidays.
It starts the
7th.
I think it's the
7th.
14th,
15th,
16th.
Okay.
Midterms are.
No.
This looks like after
exams.
I think it's around the
16th-ish.
Yeah,
they start the
14th. I know it's not during. It's not the same week.
They'll have their exams.
Yeah.
And then
it's
for two different
things
and whatnot.
Yeah.
I imagine that
would be a pressure month to. Yeah, a lot of students will do it in December. I mean, they start out, 4 weeks out and start with the SATs. But yeah, it is. I mean,
it's for
how much
it's very reasonable.
Yeah.
On top of the SAT, it's reasonable how much of it.
I want to say 52. And on the ACT, one thing I do want to say is on the ACT, do take the writing. It says optional.
Yeah.
It's really not optional. And you'll learn that a lot of things through college, when it says optional, especially when you get to the applications, it's not optional. Okay, so nothing's optional.
ACT, and it's
the writing
portion.
Yeah.
What's learning from that
Because they really do, the way it's laid out, it makes it sound like it's really optional, but colleges will not accept an ACT unless they have the writing, so it's not optional. I guess the only benefit to that is if you have a really high, you take it the first time you have a really high score, and you just want to work on the other scores, you wouldn't have to take it your second time. So I guess that's the benefit of that. Okay? If we don't have any questions, then we are dismissed and you go back to class. Have a great day. Thanks for coming.